All right. So where we're at now in the course is that we spent all the last couple weeks sort of going down the stack through the storage architecture. Right? We talked about concurrency control a little bit in the beginning, but we sort of went from indexes to now the storage models to the storage format to now compression, and then we did logging and recovery. So at this point in the course, now we're going to go back around to the top of the system. And now we're going to take in queries. And now we're going to figure out how to actually generate query plans for them. Then we'll talk about how to execute them or schedule them. Then we'll talk about different join algorithm implementations. Then we'll get into the really good optimizations doing compilation and vectorization. So sort of we went through down the first time to say how to actually do you want to store data. Now we're looping back around and saying how do you actually execute queries on this. And I started off concurrency control in the beginning because I think that really keeping concurrency control in the back of your mind throughout everything we talk about is really important because it affects pretty much everything. Right, as we saw, it affects what recovery algorithm you use, a logging scheme you can use. It affects what indexes you can use. So that's why I sort of focused on that first, and then we talked about storage. Now we're going back and talking about execution. So for today's class, and then on Tuesday next week, now we're going to talk about actually how do you implement a query optimizer. So again, this is the query shows up, you need to generate a query plan for it, and fire it off. So for today's agenda, we're going to first start sort of a rough background, a high-level background on what query optimization actually means in the context of databases, and then we'll spend a little bit of time talking about the basics, about the things we're going to care about in our optimizer implementation, and then we'll spend most of our time talking about the different ways to actually implement an optimizer. You guys read the Volcano optimizer paper, which is sort of one way to do it, and then on Tuesday next week, we'll talk about Orca, which is an implementation of the Cascades optimizer strategy. So we're going to skip. We're not going to talk about Cascades in this class. We'll focus more on that on next class, and I'll only touch briefly on what sort of Volcano does at the end, because then that'll set up for everything we talk about next week on Tuesday. And so we're going to go through all these different search strategies because I think it's important to see here's all the different approaches people have tried, and that helps them motivate why you want to use Cascades. All right, so in a database system, for query optimization is basically trying to solve the problem of given some query from the application, whether it's in SQL or any language you want, we want to be able to find a correct execution plan that's going to have the overall lowest cost amongst other query plans for that same query. And so I'm sort of emphasizing two points in this sentence here. I'm first emphasizing the word correct, because obviously if we choose a plan that may be the fastest but produces an incorrect result, then that's useless to us. So we're going to have to make sure as we go along and we maybe transform our query and explore different options in the plans, we want to make sure that we're still always producing a correct result. And then I'm putting lower cost in quotation marks here because it's not a cost in something like that is can be measured outside of the system. I mean, it's not going to be like wall clock time or something that's in the physical world. This cost is going to be sort of internal and relative to other query plans for that particular database instance. So again, we'll talk more about cost estimations and cost models next week. But then the thing to be mindful about this is that the database system needs to have some way to say for this given query plan and that given query plan for the same query, which one do I think is going to be better? And that depends on your operating environment, depends on a bunch of different factors, which I'll cover in a few slides. So I argue that this is doing query optimization, building a query optimizer, is actually the hardest thing you can do in a database system to implement well. And we'll see as we go along. And part of the reason it's so hard is because it's proven to be NP complete. For some simple queries, query optimization is not very difficult. You just find the exact index you need. But if you have, say, a 35-way join or a 40-way join, then figuring out the correct ordering of all those things is obviously going to be you're going to have exponential choices, and so it's going to be very, very difficult to do. So we have this sort of tricky problem where we need to be able to find a good query plan, but we kind of need to do this in what I'll say in real time, in that like if someone's at the terminal and hits enter to send a query in, we want to be able to generate a good query plan, you know, right then and there. We don't want it to be the case that like if the optimal query plan might take 5 seconds, but it takes us 20 seconds to find it, then that's a bad trade-off. So because of this, no true optimizer is actually going to produce what I'll call the true optimal plan. Again, for certain things, you can always find the optimal plan because the choice is very easy, right? We'll see this in a second. But for more complicated joins, it's just simply impossible, right? Because you can crunch this for years and years and years. So what we're going to do instead, we're going to use estimation techniques to guess what the real plan is going to be and guess what the real cost is going to be. And then some of these techniques will apply heuristics and other rules to allow us to cut down the number of different options or plans we have to look at to reduce the search space, to make this thing actually be tractable and something that we can do in a reasonable amount of time. So just a quick high-level overview of what sort of this a query optimizer architecture looks like. Say we have an application, and they submit us a SQL query. The first phase that we can go into is what's usually called the SQL rewriter. So actually, what I'm showing in this sort of this pipeline here, anything that's in the dark boxes, so the parser, binder, and optimizer, these are things you absolutely need to have. Like you can't do query optimization without one of these. The boxes in the light gray, these are what I consider optional things. Some systems have them, some systems don't. Some systems, and you don't always need them. And we're not really going to discuss whether you want to use them or not. I'll just say that sometimes they're called different things. Sometimes the binder has this thing inside of it. Sometimes this thing is inside of that. Right? The high-level idea is roughly the same. And in the end, you're still going to produce an optimal query plan, but how you got there depends on the implementation. So the SQL query comes in, and the first phase, the first component we could go into is a SQL rewriter. And this would be taking the actual raw SQL string and not inferring any semantics about what tables it's trying to access or anything like, what it's actually trying to do. There's some basic regular expressions you can apply to them to maybe modify them to make them more tractable or easier to optimize. So the MySQL 8, which is actually not out yet, they have plugins that allow you to do basic simple transformations, like maybe converting something that's a complex a bunch of ors into an in clause or something like that. The SQL writer still spits out a SQL query, and then you pass that into your parser, and that's going to break up, it's like any other parser in for programming languages. It's going to break up the strings into tokens and then generate an abstract syntax tree that explains what the SQL query actually was about. And then we feed that abstract syntax tree into what is called the binder. And this is where we're going to convert the string names of tables and other objects in our database into actual identifiers that the system knows about. Right? So this, you use the system catalog to say, for table name foo, get back a unique identifier for that table. So then you can use that going forward in all your planning. So what this thing, the binder, spits out is what is called an annotated AST. Which basically, it's the same thing as this guy here, but just now it has, instead of having names for tables, it has identifiers, or it has offsets for columns and things like that. So then now you can pass this into what's called a tree rewriter. And again, in the case of Postgres, this thing is usually embedded inside the binder. It doesn't have to be a separate component. And this is basically going to allow you to do some other early optimizations directly on the AST that you may want to do, like simple things like doing predicate pushdowns or things like that. And then that thing then feeds into what we're going to focus on in this class here is the optimizer. And that's actually going to do the more complex search to figure out how to turn your logical plan you're getting from this thing or the annotated AST into an actual physical plan. And the physical plan is going to specify exactly how to execute that particular query. And so for some of these techniques, there'll be some kind of cost model or estimator that we can say, for this physical plan, and given this state of the database, what's the estimated cost of executing that query? And again, I said it's an internal cost. You can't compare different database systems' cost models. It allows it, again, to be able to guess that one query plan's mean better than another. So like I said, in our current system, we have a parser from this system called HiRISE. But it turns out that thing is implements SQL incorrectly, so we're ripping that out and replacing that with the Postgres parser. Patrick and his team just wrote the new binder for our database system for Impeloton, so we can now pull things from the catalog and get annotated ASTs. And then Patrick's team is also implementing the new optimizer for us. So this is actively working on this topic right now, which is sort of why I'm interested in spending 3 days on it. So the big thing to understand what's going to happen in query optimizer is that we're going to convert a logical plan into a physical plan. And so you can think of like the annotated AST as the logical plan, because it's just saying at a high level what the query actually wants to do. So it says, like, I want to read from table foo. I want to join table A with table B. But it doesn't say anything about how you actually should execute that, right? And because that information is specified in the physical plan. So the physical operators are going to say, specify the exact strategy or algorithm you're going to use to execute whatever it is the operator you're trying to do. Right? So say you want to join table A and table B. The logical plan would say join table A, join table with B. The physical plan would say join table A with B using a hash join on this key with this size hash table and this number of threads, right, using this type of hash table. Like, all this is specified in the physical plan. So what we're doing in our optimizer, we're basically trying to convert these logical algebra expressions into the physical algebra expressions, right? And what makes this sort of tricky is that there's not always going to be a one-to-one mapping from a logical plan operator to a physical plan operator. Sometimes they can be split, sometimes they can be merged together. So an easy example of this would be, like, say you have your relational algebra plan that has does a lookup on a table, followed by a filter, followed by a projection. Well, in the physical plan, you could actually condense those three operators into a single scan operator and then do the projection and filtering as you read out tuples. You don't have to have another physical operator just to do the filtering. So this is what I mean, that it's not always going to be straight one-to-one mapping. And when we talk a little bit more about cascades next week, we'll be seeing some cases where, you know, it can combine and split these things on the fly. So the way we're going to be able to ensure that we're going to generate correct plans at a sort of logical level is that we can rely on the semantics of relational algebra to ensure that we generate plans that are equivalent. So again, in the original paper from Ted Codd on relational model, he sort of lays out this algebra and says, you know, there's all these commutativity and associativity properties that will allow us to reorder the logical and physical operators for an equivariate plan and still end up with the correct result. And so this is going to allow us, the optimizer, to have more flexibility to decide how it should you know, order different operations in the query plan. Of course, the downside is that because they're so, you can generate a ton of different equivalent expressions, this makes the search space much larger. So we have to come up with a way to deal with this, right? So again, this is basically the same stuff we covered in intro class, right? If I'm doing a join between A, B, and C, I can join B and C first, then A, and that's considered equivalent to joining A, C first, followed by B. Right? And our optimizer is going to know this. It's going to know about what these equivalency rules are going to be, and they can generate different permutations of our query plan. We sort of throw that into our search algorithm to find the one with the lowest cost. All right, so one key observation we need to make in the beginning is that doing query planning and query optimization for transactional workloads or OLTP workloads is really easy to do. And this is because typically OLTP queries are known as being sargeable. So sargeable stands for search argument able. And the basic way to think about this is that in the query, in the where clause, it'll tell you exactly what attributes it wants to look up. And if you have an index that has exactly those columns or those attributes, you don't really need to look at all different possible combinations. You know exactly what index you need to pick. And you know exactly how to run that query in the most efficient manner. So let's say I have a table that has a primary key on the column ID. If my query is select star from table where ID equals 4, I don't need to even look at other indexes. I know exactly what index I want to look at to go directly to get the data that I need. So this is what is called a sargeable query. So this is when we talk about doing heuristics in early optimizers. This is essentially the problem that they're solving, right? Because it's really easy to do. For joins, it's in OLTP settings, they're almost always going to be lookups on foreign key relationships. So again, the same thing, that you just know exactly what index to use to combine these things, two things together. Like, if I want to get, you know, for my customer account, get all my orders, again, I'm going to be doing a index lookup to get my account and then the index lookup to get my orders. And I don't need to look at different permutations of join orders and things like that. So again, you're going to implement this with simple heuristics, as we'll see in a second. So the main takeaway is that for sargeable queries, for OLTP workloads, query optimization is actually really easy. I would play, you know, I can't prove this, but probably 95% of the queries can be easily done like this. And this is essentially what we do in Peloton's current optimizer, right? We only can handle searchable queries. So for this lecture and for next class and next week, we're really going to be focusing on OLAP queries because they're not always going to be searchable. They're not always going to have an index. And it's going to be way more complicated to figure out the optimal plan. So we have to do a bunch more work. So just keep in the back of your mind, for OLTP, it's pretty easy. For OLAP, it's much harder, and that's what we're focusing on here. So I sort of alluded to this in the beginning about determining whether one plan is better than another for a query based on a cost estimation. And again, we'll talk about more about this next week, but the basic idea of way to think about this is that the cost for executing a query depends heavily on what kind of database system you're using and its operating environment, right? So you can think of it like if I running on a mobile phone, then maybe my cost model might want to be how much energy does a join algorithm use? Because maybe I don't want to wear out the battery. Or if I have a distributed database system, my cost model would estimate the amount of data I have to move back and forth over the network. For our purposes, for the most part, we're going to be mostly focusing on the size of intermediate results, but there's a bunch of different things you can consider when you're doing the cost estimation, which we'll focus on more next week. One of the hard things to do in cost estimation is, though, dealing with understanding how queries interact with other queries. And this is hard because when you say, all right, I want to generate the cost of executing this query, you now have to take an account of like whatever else is running at the exact same time as you run that query. And although this can allow you to do certain things like, say I have a query that's running for a minute, and then I have a bunch of short queries that I want to run, the best plan, if a query is running by itself, might take 1 second, but if that other query is still running, it might take 5 seconds. But there might be another plan that would normally be the worst, but actually under this situation would be the best. So all these different trade-offs and how these queries interact with each other is really, really hard to model. And there are many situations, if you did this correctly, you can get better performance. But in practice, nobody actually does this. So again, the main takeaway is that cost estimation is going to allow us to figure out, without actually having to run the real query, what query plans will be better than another. And it's always going to be approximation, and it's always specific to that database instance at that particular point in time. All right, so now we want to talk about the different design choices we can have when we implement our optimizer. So the three things we're going to care about are what's sort of the granularity or the scope of the queries that we're going to try to optimize, when we actually do our optimization, and this thing called plan stability, which is sort of a way to make sure that the query optimizers can produce the same optimal query plan, even when we ask it multiple times for the same query. So for granularity, there's basically two choices. So the first choice is that we can just generate a single query plan for just the one query at a time. This is what normally people think of when you learn about query optimizers in an intro class. This is pretty much what we tell you how query optimization works. Like a query shows up, I ignore everything else that's running inside the system at the same time, and I just do my query optimization for just that one single query. This is nice because it's easier to implement. It'll be faster to do the optimization for that single query because the search space is much smaller. But the downside is, again, you're not going to be able to easily model the interaction of other queries running at the same time, and like I just showed in the previous slide, because you have no notion of what else is running. So you assume your query is going to run in isolation, but in reality, it may not actually be the case. The other choice is to do query optimization across multiple queries. So think of this as like I submit a batch of queries all at once, and I figure out how they're going to interact with each other, and I choose a query plan that may be the global optimal for all of them, but maybe not the optimal choice for each one individually. But in the long run, if I run all these queries at the exact same time, I'm going to get better performance. So this is obviously harder to do because the search space is much larger. And this is only really useful for a technique called scan sharing, which I'll talk about later in the semester. The basic idea here is that when a query shows up, if you know another query is going to run at the exact same time and do more or less the same thing, scan the same table, rather than having two separate threads scan through the same table separately and produce results, maybe you combine them together and they can piggyback off of each other and reuse the same tuples as they go along. Again, we'll focus more about this later in the semester. None of the open source guys do this, but the commercial guys can do this. Like if you say, in a disk-based system, say you have one thread that's doing a complete sequential scan on the table, it gets about halfway through before another query shows up and wants to do the same kind of sequential scan. Rather than him starting at the beginning and trashing your buffer pool, you have him jump on with the first guy, and they go down to the end, and then the first guy gets off, and he's done, and the second guy recognizes that, I missed a bunch of stuff at the beginning, let me go back and read it. So that's where it's called scan sharing, and that'll show up later on in the semester. So for single queries, this can be expensive to do, but because you're doing it on a per query basis, but you can use stored procedures to kind of get around this, right? You can use prepared statements to do a bunch of the planning ahead of time so that you're not doing it on every single query invocation. And that's sort of related to the next topic we have to deal with, the next design choice is, when do we actually perform our optimization? So again, the first choice is what we tell you in the intro class, and this is called static optimization. The query shows up, and I do my optimization for that particular moment of time, and then I go ahead and execute it. And I never go back and as the query executes and figure out whether that was the right choice or not. So this is highly dependent on how good your cost model is going to be, because if your estimations are really bad, then you're going to choose an unoptimal or non-optimal plan. And of course, now this depends on how good your statistics and other catalog information you're maintaining about what your data looks like, which is hard to keep up to date. Again, we'll focus more about that in the next class, next week. But to way to get around having to do this every single time for every single query, as I said, you can use prepared statements to do all the optimization ahead of time so that when you now want to actually run the query, you just pass in the handle of the name of the prepared statement, and the database system goes in its plan cache and go grabs the pre-optimized query and just runs that. The tricky thing with prepared statements, though, as I said earlier, is that in many cases, they're going to have placeholder variables in its predicates, for its where clause, like where ID equals question mark or input parameter. And so in the optimizer, you can't actually do get the optimal plan for that particular query because you don't know what the values are going to be at runtime every time you invoke that prepared statement. So typically what they'll do is they'll take the average, the database system will take the average value and substitute that for the placeholder and do all your optimization based on that. But obviously, depending on the cardinality of the data and whatever input parameter you use, you can have wildly different performance if you have a lot of skew in your data set. So this is not always, it's not ideal, but it's better than having to do it every single time. Another approach is to do dynamic optimization, and this is where you just literally just take the logical plan or the annotated AST that comes out of the binder before you got to the optimizer, and just do a straight mapping of logical operators to physical operators. And then what happens is, as you start executing them, you take the logical plan and then you start executing it, and on the fly you'll convert them from a logical operator to a physical operator, and you determine based on what data you're seeing which of these operators, which physical plan you actually want to use. This approach actually can do sometimes also too is if you say you start off doing executing the query using one type of operator, one type of hash join, if you recognize that your assumptions about what the data look like turns out to be incorrect, you can modify the plan on the fly and switch off to use another join algorithm. It's not easy to do, and I don't think anybody actually really does this in the context of a data warehouse. Typically you see this one instead. But where this is actually useful is for stream processing systems or continuous query systems, right? So this would be something like where you say, I want to run some query that would notify me when some event occurs in my data stream. And you sort of do the initial planning, and then you install that query, and sort of like a trigger that gets fired off when some event occurs. And then over time, if you notice that the data you're processing as it comes in through the stream looks a lot different than your original assumptions, you can just do the replanning the entire thing over and over again. Right? Because this is sort of different scope than this, because this is sort of like one-off query that you fire off. This is sort of something that's continuously running. So in addition to being difficult to implement, this is also difficult to debug because it can change dynamically on the fly, and it's hard to figure out, to go back and say whether that was a good choice or not, whether, to understand why your query might be running slower than you expect it to be. The last choice is to do hybrid optimization, which is a combination of these two. So this is where, again, the query comes in, you immediately generate a query plan for it, and then over time as you run, if you recognize that your estimations about what was going to happen when you execute the query turn out to be incorrect, then you can modify how you're actually going to finish the query. So the tricky thing to be mindful about this is that if the cost benefit you're going to get to do the reorganization or the reoptimization is going to be less than what it's going to take you to reorganize the query or reoptimize the query, then you don't want to do this. Let's say you have a query that took 60 seconds to run, and around you're at 60 seconds into it, and then you know you have another 60 seconds to go. But if you reoptimize the query plan, you can maybe get it down to another 40 seconds. But if it takes you 50 seconds to do that reoptimization, then that's not a good trade-off. So typically, they have some way to estimate whether it is actually worth reoptimizing based on how much work I have left to do. So one example of this approach is actually done in Greenplum. So what Greenplum will do is they won't change the actual what algorithm you'd use for a join, but if they start doing a hash join and they recognize that the hash table size is too small because their estimates were off, then they can dynamically on the fly resize the hash table to reduce the number of collisions you have, and that can speed things up. So that's an example of what you can do here. So you're not really changing the algorithm, but you're changing sort of like the characteristics of the physical operator. All right, the last thing we need to talk about is plan stability. And the idea here is that in enterprise settings, typically they don't like having wild fluctuations in the run times of their queries. It's always good that things get faster, but if some things get faster, some things get slower, then that's bad. And so in the commercial database systems, they have a lot of additional mechanisms that allow you as the human to instruct the database system how it should generate different query plans. All right, so the first choice is to use hints, and this is basically where you as the human write in your SQL queries annotations to tell the optimizer what you want it to do. So for example, if you know that you really want to use a hash join for this particular query, you can annotate it with a hint and say, don't use sort merge, use a hash join on these predicates. Or you can change the join orders and things like that. And the optimizer will take that into consideration when it generates the plan. So this is actually what MySQL actually supports this. All the commercial systems support this. So then like in SQL Server, what you can do, if you have a prepared statement, you can extract out the query plan as an XML file. And they have tools that allow you to go back and annotate things and tweak things, and then feed that back into the system. Another approach is to allow the DBA to specify what version of the optimizer they want the system to use to generate query plans. So let's say, for example, like you're running Oracle 10, and you want to upgrade to Oracle 12, but you don't. For some of your queries, everything gets faster, but for a small percentage of them, they get actually slower. So you want to go revert back to the old version of the optimizer because that generated query plans or costs that had were uniform and weren't wildly different. So what you can do is when you call a prepared statement or load a query, and you can specify, here's the new query I want, but use your optimizer as a version 10. And actually what happens in the Oracle binaries, they'll include all the different versions of the optimizer from all the previous versions of the system that allow them to switch on one versus another. They're all sort of compatible with the entire new version of the system. So what happens in this case here, there may be some new operators or new optimizations that come out in the newer version, but you want the old plans that won't take advantage of them because that won't slow down other systems or other queries. And the last one is to have, sort of related to this, but have backwards compatible plans. And the idea here is that before you do your upgrade from the old version of the system to the newer version, you dump out all your cached query plans into like an XML file. And then when you install the new system, you load them all back in, and it knows that these query plans were generated from a previous optimizer, and it uses them rather than trying to do replanning. And again, this is important, again, in an enterprise setting because it's not good to upgrade to a new version of the system when, if 90% of your queries get faster but 10% of them get slower, people are going to complain that those 10% of the queries got slower rather than thank you that the other ones got faster. So this is what they care about. And we'll see in some cases with the, when we look at randomized algorithms, because these things can be non-deterministic, it's important to have these overrides. All right, so any questions about the basics of what we're going to want in an ideal optimizer, what the things we're going to care about? So now we can talk about the different search strategies. So there'd be five different approaches that I'll go through. And as we go along in this discussion, I'm going to talk about in terms of like what I think is actually, you know, which one produced the best plans, which one I think is faster. But one thing that's going to be really important as we go along all this as well is that we're also to discuss what it takes to actually implement these approaches, the sort of software engineering side of things. Because it's great, you know, it's great that we can have an awesome optimizer that can generate awesome query plans, but if it's impossible for us to maintain or possible for us to extend, then it's essentially useless, right? Because no one except for like, you know, one or two people are actually going to be able to work on it. And it's going to make it very hard for us to add new features later on. And that'll be one of the main two deficiencies for the first two guys. And then for this last one here, the last two at least, we'll see how they solve that in using a sort of declarative rule set. So another thing I'll say also too is that like I said in the beginning of the class that like this course was not going to be about reading classic papers and databases. And I realized the Volcano paper you guys read was from, I think, 1993. And that was probably before some of you were actually born. For the first two approaches, these are from the 70s, so I wasn't even born then. And what I'll say, the reason why we can read these older papers is that although the hardware has changed, although the complexity of the workload has changed, they get at sort of these fundamental algorithms, fundamental approaches to how you do query optimization that are still applicable today. It's sort of like no one's really generated a better quicksort algorithm, but you know, quicksort is really old. The same kind of idea here. The basics are still sound, but we can talk about how to maybe optimize them for in the modern context. Okay? All right, so the first approach we're going to talk about is doing heuristic-based optimization. So this is what you would essentially end up doing if you build a database system from scratch and you're like, oh, I need a query optimizer. This is what pretty much everyone does. This is what our current optimizer does. And so the basic idea is that you're going to have these static rules that are going to be written in your database system that's going to allow you to transform the logical operators to a physical plan. And I sort of listed the four main rules that you always end up doing, right? Simple things like make sure you perform the most restrictive selections first. That way you can get rid of as much data as possible. You want to perform all your filters and during your scans before you actually do your joins. And you do predicate limit and projection pushdowns. And then to figure out the join order for tables, you just do a simple heuristic, like pick the one that has the smallest cardinality and use that to figure out which one goes before the other. So this was actually what was implemented by Mike Stonebreaker and his team at Berkeley when they built Ingress. And this is actually what was implemented in Oracle, surprisingly up until the mid-1990s. And you maybe think this is really crazy. How did Oracle get so big and so popular when they're doing like the most simplest query optimizer? And I'll say two things about that. Is one is, you know, they had a lot of people because they had a lot of money that could really hammer at their heuristic based optimizer and make it be as good as it was going to be, right? So near the end, it was actually pretty impressive piece of code. I've heard it was terrible to maintain, right? They had a whole floor apparently of people just working on this thing. But it got them pretty far. The other aspect I'll say about this is that you have to understand that in back then, the not only were the size of the databases people were dealing with much smaller than what we have today, but also the complexity of the queries that they wanted to execute and on this data was much more simple. Right? Again, think of like the SQL 92 standard. It has your basic selects and joins and aggregation functions. But it doesn't have all the more complicated things like CTEs, window functions, and all the things that you can do in SQL today. So the queries that they had to support back then were operating on smaller databases and were less complex. And that's why they got pretty far with the heuristic-based approach. So I want to show an example of how the Ingress optimizer worked. And I'll use this example running table going through all the different search strategies. For this, we're using the sample database we have is a sort of a clone of a Spotify database or a music application. So we're going to have one table that contains all the artists, another table that contains all the albums that they put out, and then we'll have a cross-reference table called appears that says, you know, for a particular album, here are the artists that appeared on it. So the query we're going to want to run is they want to get all the names of the people that appeared on my mixtape that I dropped last year. And so we're doing a three-way join between the artist table, appears, and album. And we see that in the case of the artist, we're doing, again, lookup between the cross-reference table for both album and artist and album. So the way the ingress optimizer worked was it was actually going to have to decompose this into single table queries, because ingress, at least in the earlier version, did not support joins. Right? So they had to rewrite this query into single select statements. So, right, so the first thing we're going to do is going to decompose this thing into single variable queries or single table queries. So we'll start off with taking the first query, the original query, and we'll break out the select on the album table, and we'll write that into a temporary table, temp1. And then we'll rewrite the original query now to replace album with the temp table we generated up above. And now we'll do this again. Now we'll take this thing and decompose this into two separate select statements, right? So we would end up with query 3 and query 4. Query 2 goes away. So query 3 is going to take the output of temp 1 and do a join with the appears table. And then query 4 would take the output of temp 2 and do the join with the artist table. So remember I said you can't do joins in ingress. So what then they would now go back and do is execute these queries one by one and then substitute the values that they have in their where clause with the output of the previous query. So in this first case, we execute this first query and we get some album number 999. Then now we're going to feed that into the input for this query here and replace the join lookup with just the 999. So now we have a single table select statement. We get the output of this, and here now we have, since we have two artists. We can then rewrite this net query down to be two separate select statements that both do a lookup on either the first result or the second result. So then this produces our correct result. So in this case here, they did this all with heuristics. They were able to convert this from a three-way join, not worry about how to figure out what the join order could be, and just rewrote them to be these single select statements. And again, you may be thinking like, wow, this is really kind of like inefficient because I went from doing one single select statement to now four. You again, understand, back in the 70s, they weren't running on very good hardware like we have today. And it was very limited what they could do, so they couldn't do a complex search to find the correct way to do this. I'll also say, too, is when you read the paper about this approach, they talk about operating on a database with 100 tuples, 300 tuples, right? That's nothing. Right. But back then, that was a lot, so that's why they could do this, and it still produced reasonable results. So the advantages of the heuristic-based optimization approach is that it's really easy to implement, easy within reason, right? But the code over time gets very difficult. And it's also going to be easy to debug because you know exactly what the transformation is going to be because you just look at the code and trace through it and you see what steps it takes. It's also going to work reasonably well and fast for simple queries because it's almost going to be a one-to-one mapping from the logical plan to a physical plan. The downsides are obviously is that it is going to be impossible to generate good plans when you have complex interdependencies or more complex operators like we have in SQL today. It also relies on having magic constants to be able to predict whether you're making a good decision or not. So in here before, I mean, I more or less picked the order I was going to execute these select statements, and it chose that based on how it thought the cardinality of these different operators are going to be, right? And so if you get these estimations wrong in these rules, then you may end up choosing a bad plan. So as I said, this is what Oracle did and this is what Ingress did in the 1970s. Remember, those are two of the three original database systems, relational database systems that were developed at that time. The third database system was obviously IBM System R. And they came up with a completely different approach to do cost-based estimation, or to do query optimization using a cost model. And so this was developed by a woman named Pat Selinger. And so she was one of the, you know, the team of 7 or 8 people at IBM that sort of started off working on System R. They sort of, again, they had 7 people with PhDs. Everyone went off and did their own piece of the system, and they combined it all together. So she worked on this cost-based optimizer. And this is really groundbreaking work, because this is pretty much how, at a high level, everyone's going to be doing query estimation or query optimization in current systems today. So this is the first cost-based query optimizer where we're going to have some way to estimate whether one plan was better than another. And so we're going to do this in 2 steps. So the first step, we're going to use the same heuristics or static rules that we did in Ingress and Oracle. But then when we want to figure out what's the best join order for our tables, that's when we actually do a dynamic probing approach to evaluate these different plans we choose. So we'll talk more about this later on in the class, but this approach here is using what's called bottom-up planning, or if you come from an AI background, this is called forward chaining. And the idea here is that we're going to start with nothing in our query plan, and then we're going to build it up to get to the goal that we want. And we'll see this in the volcano approach and the cascades approach. They're using a top-down model where you start at the goal you want to achieve, and then you work your way down to figure out how to get there. So, as I said, this was implemented in System R, but System R was never actually commercialized, never released. So in the early versions of IBM DB2, when it came out in the early 1980s, this is the approach that they used. And I'll also say, too, this is pretty much what every open source database system does today. So this is what MySQL does, this is what Postgres does, and as far as I know, I think this is what SQLite does as well, right? It's the same, I mean, the specifics of the algorithm may be slightly different, but it's the same high-level approach. So let's go through what System R does. So System R is going to break up our queries into these blocks, and then we'll have these logical operators for each block. So you think of a block, if, like, say you have a nested query, one block could be the inner query, the other block would be the outer query. And then it'll do planning just on individual blocks. And then it'll sort of append them all together at the end. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at, for each logical operator in a block, we're going to generate all the set of physical operators we could use to implement it. And in this first version of System R, they could only deal with join algorithms and access paths. So we're going to generate all the possible choices we can have, and then we'll have our dynamic programming search try to find, try to build up a plan that has the minimum cost. And so because this could be an exhaustive search, they're going to apply a bunch of heuristics and rules to cut down the number of solutions or plans they have to look at. So the most famous one that they apply is that they only consider what are called left deep trees. So we only have the joins on the, they only sort of go from on the left going up to the root. And this is different than right deep trees or bushy trees. And they did this for 2 reasons. One was, again, it reduces the number of things you have to look at. But also, back in the old days, when you assumed the data was going to be out on disk, having left deep trees allows you to do pipelining up the query plan. So you can take the output of one join plan, and that'll be the input, a join operator, and that'll be the input for the next join operator. You don't have to worry about materializing it out the disk as you would in a bushy tree. So now in the context of in-memory databases, since we assume everything's going to be in memory, we don't have to worry about this as much. And so we'll see in the later optimizers where they actually do consider bushy plans, because they actually turn out to be the most optimal path or plan. All right, let's go back to our example here. So this is the same query. We were going to look up my mixtape and figure out who was on it. But the one change I'm adding is that I'm adding this order by clause at the end to say I want my output to be sorted on the artist ID. And we'll see the ramifications of that in a second. So the first thing they're going to do is they're going to choose the best access path for each individual table. All right? And this is just, again, doing basic heuristics. So for this particular query, since we're doing a join on the artist table and the appears table, there's nothing in the where clause that we can use to allow us to do a probe on an index. So these will always get assumed to be sequential scans. But in the case of the album table, assuming we have an index on the name field, then we know we want to do an index lookup on that. So these are the access methods we're going to choose. And then for this, now we're going to assume that these access methods will then feed into join operators. So now we want to generate a table that has all possible enumerations of join orders. Again, this is still at the logical level. We're not saying anything about how we're physically going to do this. but you sort of think of it going from left to right. That's going to be the join order. So the two things I'll point out here in our table, right? This can go on forever for all possible combinations. We're going to include both the natural joins as well as the Cartesian joins. But again, another heuristic that will apply to reduce the search space is that they'll throw away these guys because they're usually not going to be the best approach or have the lowest cost. So then now we're going to have to use our dynamic search to find the join order with the lowest cost. So you can think of sort of like the search space would be like this. I'm only showing two possible join orders here, but you would have to have all the entries for the table I showed in the previous slide. And so these are all logical operators, right? There's nothing in there that says how you actually do any of the joins. So what you do is now generate edges that go from the base where you don't have anything joined, and you'll specify what join algorithm you want to use to get to a joined intermediate result for either of these two tables. And here you see I annotate some of them with hash join and some of them with sort merge join. So now what you'll do is you'll pick whatever one has the lowest cost going from the beginning to the next stage, and then you just do the same thing again. Now you're going to generate what are the different algorithms I can use to get to the next logical operator that I have, and again you'll compute one with you'll throw away the ones that have the highest cost. So now at this point, we want to figure out what path we're going to want to take that's going to have the lowest cost going all the way from the beginning to the end, and that's going to be the one we're going to choose. But the tricky thing about this particular example is that the query added that order by at the end of it, where we cared that the final result would be ordered on the artist table. So in that case, the sort merge is going to be better for us because the merge algorithm is going to generate the output in sorted order. So we don't have to do an additional sorting step. But the problem is, as you see, there's nothing in this search tree that says anything about the physical property of the data. I just know I executed some algorithm, but I don't know what the data actually looks like. So the correct answer is that the sort merge join is what we're going to want to use. But the way you'd actually have to make this work so that it would pick this is that inside your cost model, you'd have to write these rules to say, I know my output should be sorted, therefore give the sort merge join the lower cost than the hash join, right? And this becomes very cumbersome to do because it's not just join orders. It could be location. It could be the layout of data. There's all these other different aspects of the physical properties, what the data looks like, that's being generated out of these operators that you have to care about. But now you have to bake all this information in to your cost model. All right, so what are the advantages and disadvantages? So the first advantage is that it usually finds a reasonable plan without having to perform a complete exhaustive search. And for most, sort of reasonable queries, this does well enough. But then the problem is that we're going to have all the same issues we had in the heuristic-based approach, where we have to write these procedural code that would do these rules to do our initial transformation. In the system R case, we're pruning out anything that's not a left deep join tree, which may not be the optimal thing. And then I think the biggest issue is that we have to bake into the cost model the physical properties of the data. But that makes it also, again, very, very difficult to maintain. So we're short on time, but I'll talk a little bit about random Alice algorithms because I want to get to the Starburst and Volcano stuff at the end. But a randomized algorithm is basically, instead of having an exact search like the branch and bound or a divide and conquer search, we're going to perform a random walk over the solution space of all possible query plans, and we'll just see whether we find one that has the lowest cost. And the way this typically works is that you keep searching until you meet some threshold in terms of either I found a cost that is good enough, or I find a query plan that has a good enough cost, or until I run out of time. Like maybe I only want to do this search for about 500 milliseconds, and then I just give up and choose whatever the best plan that I saw. So the only database system that I know that actually implements something like this is Postgres's genetic algorithm, which I'll show in a second. So the first sort of paper that discussed doing this was came out of Wisconsin in 1987 by using simulated annealing. And the basic idea is that you first generate a query plan with a heuristic-based approach, and then you just do random permutations on physical operators to see whether you produce a new plan with a lower cost. All right? If it does have a lower cost, then you always accept it. If it if the cost actually gets worse, then you flip a coin, decide whether to take it, and move sort of in that direction in the solution space. And the idea is there is like this allows you to break out of local minimums because it may allow you to go down a path in the search space that you would not normally choose because the initial solution you looked at is actually worst. The key thing about makes this thing tricky is that you have to have, again, a bunch of rules to make sure that you don't violate the correctness guarantees of your query, meaning like the sort ordering again, that you don't want your thing, you don't, the query has to be sorted in this final result, you make sure you generate a query plan that does that. So there's a bunch of rules you have to write to make as you go along to make sure any permutation you make doesn't violate these things. This is essentially also what Postgres does in their genetic algorithm. So Postgres has a heuristic and it has a system R style search model in the very beginning. But if your query comes in that has a join on more than 12 tables, then they fall back into this genetic algorithm. And the basic way it works is that you're going to use the heuristic to pick out initial good plan, and then you're going to do a bunch of permutations of that plan to try different different solutions, and then you choose the one with the lowest cost, and then you move them into the next generation, and then you modify them or permute them again, and you keep doing this until you find one that you think is going to do the best. And again, the key thing again that we have to care about is that when we do the mutation from one generation to the next, we have to make sure that we always produce valid plans. So I will say that I think the random algorithms are interesting because it allows us to break out of the local minimums and possibly explore things that you wouldn't be able to explore normally. And if you don't care about the history of the different plans you've checked out in the past, then the memory overhead of this is actually very, very low. And the downside, obviously, is that you may end up doing a permutation or looking at a possible solution that you've seen in the past that you know is bad. So I think in the Postgres case, they always keep the history for this. The thing that makes this difficult in practice, though, is that it's very hard to figure out why the database system chose the plan that it chose, right? Because it's completely random. And there's a bunch of extra work you're going to have to do to make sure that the randomized algorithm is deterministic, meaning if I run it today and I get one query plan, and I run it tomorrow, I want to get the same query plan. So in the case of Postgres, when you read the documentation, they talk about how they have a random number generator that's seeded such that the same query will always generate the same random permutations from one generator to the next. And again, the reoccurring theme that we've seen over and over again is that you have to write procedural code to implement the correctness rule so that you always have a valid plan. All right, so this last piece is, again, we're seeing this over and over again, that we're having to write procedural code in Java, C++, C, whatever it is we're writing in, to make sure that we don't generate invalid plans. And this is actually really hard to do, and it's actually very error prone, because there's no way to formally verify that your transformations are going to be correct. The best way to do this, if you're doing this in a procedural way, is you have to write a fuzz test generator that just throws in a bunch of random queries into your optimizer and check to see whether anything breaks. The other issue that they have is that the generation of the physical operators from the logical ones are sort of done in a sort of with a narrow viewpoint of the actual query. So you're done this without understanding what's truly going on in the query. You're just trying to do the transformation for that one logical plan. So we saw this in the case of the system R approach, when we were going from the sort of this side to this side, we were only looking at each level of the join when we were making decisions about what operator we'd want to use. We didn't understand anything else that was coming down later. And this is a byproduct because we're going using a bottom up approach, where we're just we don't know where we're going to get, how we're going to get to where we need to go. And we just look at things at one level to the next. So the better approach is to use a declarative domain-specific language, or DSL, that's going to allow us as the database implementers to write our transformation rules in a sort of high-level declarative manner, and then we can have the optimizer essentially act as a compiler to then generate the code for us that will enforce those rules when we do our query optimization. So this is why in the Volcano paper you guys read, they talk about this thing as being like a framework or a toolkit for people to write optimizers, right? Because again, it allows you to write these rules out, whether it's relational model or whatever data model you want to use, you can write them out in a declarative way, and the compiler will take care of everything for you. So these classes of systems are called optimizer generators. There's only one that I really know about that actually was possibly used in practice outside of sort of academia, and that'll be the ORCA paper that you guys read. The basic idea, again, think of it like the optimizer now is a rule generator or a rules engine where you take the rules that you declare and allow you to do the modifications to generate new query plans. And what will happen is now the physical properties about the data that is being generated from each operator is now going to be embedded in our plan, so we can reason about whether we're generating the correct result or a better result without having to bake in additional information into our cost model. So all the information that we need to know what the sort order is, whether data is compressed or not, will be in the actual physical plan itself and not in this other code base. So the two approaches we can do this with are a stratified search, where we're going to do planning in multiple stages, and then a unified search, where all query planning logic will be embedded inside of a single search space. So this is what the Cascades Volcano model does, and then we'll see this in a second. This is what Starburst does. So for stratified search, basically you're going to have a rewrite of the logical plan using the transformation rules and put it into a optimized logical form. And the key thing about this is that in this is sort of like the tree rewrite component that I showed in the very beginning. Right? This is where that's occurring. It's not looking at the cost model. It just knows how to do some basic permutations to put something into a optimal form. So the cost is not considered at all. Then, after that, then you have now a way to map the physical, or the logical plan into a physical plan. So you can sort of think of this as like the same as the system R approach, where we apply a bunch of heuristics in the beginning to do some initial optimization, and then we do a divide and conquer search to find the best physical plan. It's sort of the same way, but again, we're not actually, we don't have to write procedural code to say if this, then that, you know, to do different rules. We can declare our rules in a high-level language and have the engine enforce this for us. So the most famous one system that does this, it was called Starburst. So this was a project out of IBM Research in the late 80s, led by this guy, Guy Lohmann, who was a pretty famous researcher at IBM who retired last year. And again, it's just like in System R. The first phase, we'll do the query rewrite. And in the second phase, we'll do the System R style dynamic programming. So this is actually what people use now in IBM DB2. So they sort of threw away the System R style query optimizer that we talked about at the beginning. And this what they use now is based on Starburst. So the Starburst optimizer works well in practice, and it gets really good performance. The things that are problematic for it, though, is that the grammar, at least as it's defined in the original paper, doesn't allow you to assign priorities for transformations. So say like I can transform my logical join to either a Cartesian product or a hash join. Clearly I want to do the hash join first and evaluate that. And they don't have easy way to do this in Starburst. In some cases too, you may have to do multiple transformations. When you use some transformations, they're sort of done in multiple steps. And for each of those steps, you then have to compute another cost estimate. And that becomes expensive because you go back into the cost model and recompute, do another computation. The last piece, which we're not really going to get into, is the rules you define in the first phase or the first stage are based on this derivative of relational calculus, which is not very natural in some cases. And there's papers around the time to talk about how this is actually difficult to maintain for sort of average developers. We don't really need to get into that too much, but just again, from a software engineering standpoint, it's considered that the cascade approach is easier to do. All right, so the next model is to do unified search. And in my opinion, this is actually the better way to do this. This seems more natural to me. And the idea is here is that we're going to have a single search tree, and that we're going to be able to do logical to logical and logical physical transformations all in that single space. So we don't need to have multiple stages, like a rewriter, and then do the search. It's all done in the context of one search tree. Now, the problem with this, though, is that it's going to generate a lot more transformations because it's looking at everything. And the way they're going to cut this down on having to do redundant calculations is that they're going to make heavy use of memoization using a hash table to save the cost of certain transformations so that you don't have to revisit them. Again, we'll see more about this when we talk about cascades on Tuesday. But because they're doing top-down, they can make use of this and avoid having these redundant computations. So the volcano optimizer, the paper you guys read, was from the early 90s. And to put it in perspective, in the paper they talk about this thing called Exodus. And Exodus was sort of the first generation optimizer generator that Gertz Graffy worked on. And the volcano is the second generation. And then the Cascades will be the third one, and that's considered still state of the art. And this is the same guy, Gertz Graffy, that wrote the paper on the survey of B-tree locking and latching that you guys read a few weeks ago. And this volcano is the same volcano that we use to describe the iterator model of doing, you know, processing queries at a tuple at a time. It's all in the context of the same project. So it's going to be, volcano optimizer is going to be a general cost-based optimizer that it's going to have a bunch of equivalence rules, allows you to do these transformations, and we can write them in a declarative manner. And the key thing about it is that it can record the physical properties directly inside these operators so that we know whether something is sorted correctly or not without having to have extra logic inside the cost model. And then the key difference between everything else we talked about so far is that it's going to be using a top-down approach, or in AI terms, backward chaining, to start with what you want the goal to be and then figure out what it takes to actually get there. So in this version of Volcano, this optimized Volcano, as far as they know, it was never actually implemented in any real system outside academia. They talk about a couple of different systems that from other different universities that use this. It's the Cascades approach that we'll talk about next time is that's actually used in production in real systems. So we talk a little about, you know, at the beginning, the distinction between top-down and bottom-up. And the way to sort of think about this is, again, in the top-down approach, you start with what you want the answer to be. I know I want these things to be joined, and I know I want my, you know, data to be sorted, or I want some kind of aggregation. And then you go down and you start adding operators into your query plan that will produce the answer that you're looking for. And the nice thing about top-down is that you actually apply branch and bound search on this so that you know if you add an operator that has a higher cost than the lowest cost you've seen for any possible query plan, you don't need to explore all the way down in the tree. You can then prune it off early. Whereas in the bottom-up approach, again, you may have to traverse down paths as you get towards the goal that you end up being useless to you and have a higher cost. So you end up doing more work than you actually need to. So let me show you an example of what this looks like with Volcano. So let's say we had that same query plan that I showed before. We want to get all the people that appeared on my mixtape. So again, you start off at the top, the root. You have your join, and then you know you're doing an order by. So in this case here, this is a logical operator, but we're annotating with what we want the physical data to look like, right? So we want our data to be ordered by the artist ID. So then we're now going to invoke these rules, these transformation rules that we define in our DSL to do either logical to logical transformations. So in this case here, taking a join to A and B and then flipping the order, so it's a join B and A, or logical to physical, where we can take the join A and B and say you want to implement it with a hash join. So for this, we have a bunch of these logical operators, and then now we want to figure out what are the physical, do transformations to figure out what are the physical operators we need to get there. So in the first case here, we could say we could do a sort merge join using the output of the join on artists and appears and the output of a scan on the album table. So I'm not sort of showing that you can have access path methods here because that's another transformation from the logical operator to a physical operator. But you assume that you would have something in here as well. So then now we can keep going down the path of this tree. It would say, all right, now in order to produce, oh, awesome. That sucks. I guess we need to come back. Why don't we just stop here? Because it's 10 minutes to go, and this thing's going to take 5 minutes to finish, and then we'll be out of time. So I'll focus more on the Cascades, and I'll finish up just talking to Volcano. Again, the main thing to understand when you read the ORCA paper, it's basically the same approach that I was about to show you here with sort of a top-down model. They make a big emphasis in the Cascades about being object-oriented, because that sort of was in vogue in the 90s. But there's other aspects of it that are relevant, like you can delay doing expansion of relational algebra to different equivalence classes until you actually need them. So in the case of Volcano, like when you start off, you generate all possible logical operators that are equivalent with each other. And that increases the search space, but some of them may not actually need. But then in Cascades, you can do them on demand. So you can prune down the number of things you have to evaluate by not expanding the entire search space all at once. All right, let's see. I'll go back and talk about the Volcano example when it comes back. Almost there, halfway. Three, two, one. All right, that took 2 minutes, sorry. All right, we were generating physical operators to feed into logical operators that then can then feed into other physical operators, and we have rules to do these transformations. And then we can also generate the different combinations of physical operators, right? This is doing hash join, this is doing sort merge, and all the same sort of thing. We can evaluate as we go along, as we sort of go from the top down to evaluate the different costs of these things. All right, and so what's gonna happen also in Volcano 2, there'll be enforcer rules that'll be in the search space that are gonna allow us to require that the output of a physical operator be in a certain form, right? So in this case here, we know that we want our data to be ordered by artist ID. So that means that if we have a physical operator that we know is gonna be a hash join, we can immediately prune it because it would violate that physical property enforcement rule that we have. Same thing now, say that since we know it needs to be sorted, we can add a physical operator to the quick sort and then feed that into a hash join. But at this point, we know that the cost of doing the quick sort and the hash join is greater than the cost of doing the straight sort merge join. So we can immediately cut that off and not keep going down and exploring different options. And this is just basic branch and bound search, which you can't do in the system R bottom-up approach. So we'll discuss more of this next class. So the advantages of using Volcano is that just like in Starburst, you're gonna have declarative rules that allow you to generate these transformations. It has better extensibility of how it does its search because you can start reducing the number of things you have to look at because you know that it can't be better than the best plan you've seen so far. And I sort of mentioned this when it was down, but the way it works now is you generate all possible combinations of permutations for your different logical operators. And here I'm only showing sort of three tables or three join orders, but you could have possibly everything else. So what they'll do is in Cascades, they'll allow you to do this lazily on the fly as you need them so that you don't expand the search space all at once. The other thing that's hard to do is they can't do any rewriting on predicates, and that's not something we haven't even talked about so far. Like if I have a where clause, maybe I want to modify what the where clause looks like to put it into a more optimal form. You can do that with heuristics, you can do that with the tree rewriter. But ideally, you want to be able to do this all in the context of a single optimizer. So in Cascades, we'll solve that problem. All right, so what are my parting thoughts? It should go without saying that query optimization is hard. It's not only do you need a good efficient search algorithm, but you actually need a good cost model, a good cost estimator. And this is part of the reason why none of the NoSQL guys, when they came out, they did support a SQL or did any of this. right? They would require you to write however, you know, whatever the algorithm you wanted to write, you had to write it yourself. Like, it's not only in the context of things like Cassandra and MongoDB, although both of them are trying to add back, you know, cost-based optimizer. Think of like in Hadoop, when Hadoop first came out, you had to write all your MapReduce jobs to compute joins manually yourself. And now they have things like Presto and Hive sit on top of it, and those things have a cost-based optimizer like in System R. So this is really important, and it's hard to do right, and that's why you're starting to see some of these systems add this back after the fact. All right, so for next class, we're going to spend more of our time talking about Cascades, and you'll see how it's closely related to Volcano. The paper I assigned you guys to read is a newer paper from the Green Plum guys called Orca, and this is a modern implementation of Cascades. And they designed this thing to be extensible so that like you could run your query optimizer on one machine, and you could have different distributed databases or different databases connect to it and take advantage of its resources. Like, so they could talk about having Hawk or Greenplum or whatever system you want connect to a Cascades optimizer that just does the search for you. And I'll talk a little bit about Columbia, which was an academic project that is also based on Cascades that came out of Portland State in the late 90s. Any questions? Okay, awesome. All right, we're done. I'll see you guys on Tuesday next week. Thanks.